بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله حمد الشاكرين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد طب القلوب ودوائها ونور الأبصار وضيائها وعافية الأبدان وشفائها وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد كلما ذكرك الذاكرون وغفل عن ذكرك الغافلون قال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم said for indeed and this is from Al-Khutbah Al-Sharifah from the noble sermons of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam for indeed the best of conversation is the book of Allah and the best of guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam and the worst of matters sharr al-umuri muhdathatuha are all newly invented things wa kullu muhdathatin bid'ah every newly invented matter is an innovation in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa kullu bid'atin wa kullu muhdathatin bid'ah wa kullu bid'atin dalalah and every innovation is misguidance wa kullu dalalatin fin nar and every misguidance is in the hellfire this means anything new invented in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which has no basis in al-Qur'an al-Kareem or the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam it is deemed as a bid'ah in the religion and any bid'ah in the religion is deemed as being dalala, misguidance. In a hadith related by Sayyidatuna Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha, she said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said, مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَ هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ رَدُّ Whoever introduces anything in this religion of ours, فِي أَمْرِنَ هَذَا مِنْ the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is rejected. Meaning, if it has no basis from the usul, from the principles of the Qur'an and the Sunnah, if it has no basis from Al-Qur'an Al-Kareem and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha states that the first bid'ah, the first innovation people introduced after the passing away of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam was that they would eat to their full. Why? Because in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam the sunnah was if you had to eat then you eat by filling one third of the stomach with food, one third with drink and leaving a space for air. This was deemed a bid'ah that people would eat to their fill. And this is indicative of the age we live in that we observe many bid'ahs in religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the first bid'ah was doing away with al-hukmu bima anzal Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doing away with that of governance in accordance with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed. Governance with Al-Qur'an al-Kareem and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the first innovation in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the modern age. That even in previous times, at least constitutionally, in terms of dastur, they would govern according to the book of Allah. But in recent times we saw the divorce, the separation between governance and the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was foretold by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who told and instructed the Sahabi, saying that soon you shall see al-hukmu, governance, separate itself from the book of Allah. The Sahabi radiallahu anhu, he inquires, shall I follow the governors and the rulers, or shall I follow the book of Allah? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said, follow the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why in the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said regarding the book of Allah and his Ahlul Bayt, prophetic household, that these two shall never separate themselves, hatta yarida al-hawda, until they reach what? The basin. Meaning the guidance of Imam al-Hasan wal Imam al-Husayn radiallahu anhuma, that under Sayyiduna Uthman radiallahu anhu, both of these shababa ahli jannah, the youth of Ahlul Jannah, they fought jihad under Sayyiduna Uthman radiallahu anhu. They went to Persia and they fought jihad, and then they went to Libya and they fought jihad. Many people do not mention that Sayyiduna Imam al-Hasan wal Husayn radiallahu anhuma fought jihad under Sayyiduna Uthman radiallahu anhu. Their guidance is that guidance that doesn't separate itself from the Quran and the Sunnah. Hatta yarida al-hawd, until they reach the hawd, until they reach the pond, the basin. And we know that Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu anhu, he will stand at the basin as is reported authentically, and he will deter the munafiqeen from the hawd, from the basin. Additionally, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said, إِنِّي تَرَقْتُ فِيكُمُ الثَّقَلَيْنِ, I left amongst you two heavy matters. مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا مِن بَعْدِ لَن تَضِلُّ أَبَدًا, that if you grab onto these two after me, you will never be misguided. What are they? Kitab Allah, in the narration of the Muwatta of Imam Malik, Kitab Allah wa Sunnati, the book of Allah and my Sunnah. And the version in the Sahih of Imam Muslim bin Hajjaj al-Qushayri, Rahimallahu ta'ala, Kitab Allah wa Itrati, the book of Allah, and what? Itrati. What is itra? Al-itra is ashiratul rajul, those who surround a man from the household, including Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha and al-azwaj al-mutahharat, the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha instructed people in the deen in terms of those sunan, prophetic habits, which people were unaware of. And the only person who could have ever informed us is Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha. So the guidance for the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is elucidated in a hadith narrated by Imam Ibn Majah in his sunan, taraktukum ala al-mithl al-bayda la yazighu anha illa halik, layluha ka nahariha la yazighu anha illa halik, that I left you on a clear white path. Its day is like its night is like its day, meaning in clarity. No one deviates from the Quran and Sunnah except someone who is perished. Therefore, clear guidance is found in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. In this day and age, what has enveloped people is some of the bid'at, some of the innovations, and one of those innovations is being engrossed in materialism. Being engrossed in the material dunya to the point that we have abandoned the ahkam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the point that a man, he will invest in his child, that his child, he will invest in his university education, he will invest in every material aspect of his the upbringing of his child, but he has no guarantee that his child will even reach 40 years old. He has no guarantee that his child will even become a doctor or a lawyer, whatever he invests in. He has no guarantee that his child may become a drug addict or a gambler or waste away his wealth. A man will spend years saving. Sometimes a person saves all his life, but the wealth goes in the hands of other people. He saves for others. And then in many cases, in London, you may have heard of cases where people have been cremated. Only on Friday, I led the prayer of a woman who had ostensibly no inheritors. But then her sons turned up at the burial and they demanded their mother be buried in a Christian graveyard. Why is this? Because the mother and the parents, they did not instruct their children in religion and deen of Allah, in the book of Allah and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. They instructed them in dunya, accumulating that which is guaranteed. Al-Imam Ibrahim bin Adham rahimahullah ta'ala said that the summary of ilm al-ihsan, the summary of the knowledge of perfection, is that you do not chase that which has been guaranteed for you. Your rizq is guaranteed. From the time you were born until today, when you reach the age of 50, you have been fed and clothed, not with your own planning, but with the tadbir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we thought that we were the ones planning from our childhood, then we are wrong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala planned our future, that today we are sitting here with stomachs which are full, with backs that are clothed, with full health, with immune system, sitting in the masjid listening to the dhikrullah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when a man relies on his own planning, then he is left to his own planning. So the first bid'ah in religion today is being indulgent in materialism to the point that we abandon the fard of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For instance, zakatul amwal, giving zakat on our wealth. This is a fard from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we give 1/40 of our wealth, or 2.5% on a yearly basis we should give. Some people think rizq, sustenance, is only the wealth that you accumulate. They do not realize that the sadaqah that you give is rizq. When you give the sadaqah, it grows in the hand of the poor person. And on Yawm al-Qiyamah, it will be multiplied by 700 times. But that is not the only benefit. Regarding those who does what? Amal salih, good actions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا. Such a person who does good actions, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا, whoever does a good action, مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى, from male or female, regarding them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا. We shall keep him alive on earth with what? حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا. He shall have a good worldly life also. How? You may think how? Sometimes a man may be earning £2,000 or £3,000 a week. He goes home, he spends all the money because his expenses are so high. Another man may be earning £100 a week. He goes home, he only spends £40, but when he eats lentils, what we call dal, when he eats lentils, it is as if he has been eating meat. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed barakah in his wealth. But the other man, he spends £3,000 and the £3,000 goes. He doesn't feel satisfied. He may even have an illness. He cannot even swallow the food. And if he swallows the food, he may even vomit the food. So when we give a sadaqah, a charity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guaranteed us a good life. فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةٌ طَيِّبًا. We shall make him live a pure life on earth. Sometimes, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that sometimes a treasure is lost at sea. And the treasure is only lost at sea because the person who owned the treasure, he did not give his zakatul amwal. Sometimes we wonder why our businesses have failed, why we lose tens and thousands, why we are dealing with dishonest people. But have we ever wondered, have we been giving our fadl zakat? Have we been extracting our zakat on a daily, on a yearly basis and giving it to the mustahiqeen, those who deserve from the fuqara and masakeen, the poor people, the destitute? Not only zakat. As-sadaqatu tadfa'u al-bala'. Sadaqa, charity, repels any calamity. Sometimes a calamity may be hanging over our heads, but we give a sadaqah in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, some food that may fill the stomach of a poor person, or clothes that will cover his back. And when the person's stomach is full, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes that a source of repelling a calamity. So today, the first bid'ah after abandoning ruling according to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is people being engrossed in materialism. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemns this in Al-Quran Al-Kareem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, has been ornamented for humanity. زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ, the love of desires, that they love desires, حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ, from women, meaning men love women, and some of them may go mad over a woman and destroy their dunya and their deen over a woman. مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ, and their progeny, offspring. So many people, they end up doing haram for their children. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guaranteed your rizq, you never need to do haram. When you abandon haram, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the same rizq. Or in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will multiply your rizq. مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ, from women and children. وَالْقَنَاطِيرِ الْمُقَنْطَرَةِ مِنَ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ. القناطير المقنطرة is what? Plural of قنطار. Heaped up piles of what? من الذهب والفضة, from gold and silver. الذهب is gold. What does ذهب mean in Arabic? To go. It always goes away. Yes? And Al-Imam Al-Hasan Al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala says, what a friend money is. What a friend money is, that it only benefits you when you give it away. It never stays with you. It only benefits you when you give it away. مِنَ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ, that these people, they fall in love with what? With gold and silver, gathering gold and silver. That if you do not give the zakatul amwal, it will become wabal. It becomes a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes a person may be stingy, he keeps saving and saving and saving, he doesn't realize he's benefiting someone else. How? When he dies, the money will go to others. Additionally, sometimes a man may be stingy, but he benefits someone else. How? There may be someone wanting to sell a land, he doesn't find anyone to buy the land. He looks around, no one has savings. All of a sudden, the stingy person finds out. He says, yes, I have the savings. He gives all the savings to the man and takes the land. The stingy person has benefited someone else. مِنَ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ وَالْخَيْلِ الْمُسَوَّمَةِ. What is al-khayl? Al-khayl is horses that have been marked. In today's day and age, for cars, people spend money on cars. Now they take cars and finance, which is a riba. Financing cars is a riba. And regarding riba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَا لَا يَقُومُونَ إِلَّا كَمَا يَقُومُ الَّذِي يَتَخَبَّطُهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنَ الْمَسِ. Indeed, those who consume a riba, usury, لا يقومون, they do not stand up except like the one who has been touched by the shaitan or possessed by the shaitan. Look at your London Underground today. When you wake up in the morning at 8 a.m, all those people going to work mad in order to pay their mortgages on an interest-based system. The interest-based system which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam foretold in a hadith narrated by al-Imam Abu Dawood Sulaiman ibn al-Ash'ath al-Sijistani in his Sunan, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يأتي على الناس زمان يأكل الناس فيه الربا فمن لم يأكله فيصيبه من غباره. That a time will come upon people that people will be consuming riba, usury, and whoever doesn't consume it, he will be afflicted with its dust. So the Quran says, الذين يأكلون الربا, those who consume riba, they do not stand up except like the person who has gone crazy, like the shaitan has possessed him. Today the entire city is possessed. People have no rest. They have no time for their children. They have no time for their spouses. And then the women claim that they have no time to cook at home, so the restaurants become full. And then at a later time, the women do not even have time to make tea, so they open chai wala everywhere. Yes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مِنَ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ وَالْخَيْلِ الْمُسَوَّمَةِ. Those horses that are marked off. In today's day and age, people want, they get their cars and finance, they want Porsches, they want Ferraris, they have all these different types of makes, a piece of metal that moves fast. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wal an'ami, cattle, mean possession of wealth, wal harth, and what cultivation. In today's day and age, it's the accumulation of the property folder that the Muslim today has become one of the biggest capitalists on the face of the earth. How has he become a capitalist? That he accumulates as much wealth as and exploits as many people as he wants. Look at the landlords today, Muslim landlords. They have no rahmah on their neighbors. How these HMOs that have appeared everywhere in every community, a Muslim landlord will not look what type of people is he placing in the house. Prostitutes and drug dealers and drug addicts that harm the community. And then additionally, charging extortionate rent and having no mercy on those who cannot pay. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. That is the enjoyment of the worldly life. What is dunya? Dunya is that which is close to you, but it's from a dunu, which is to be close, but it's also from a dani. What is a dani? A dani is to be low. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a hadith, what is referred to as al-hadith al-qudsi, regarding the dunya, that if it was even worth the wing of ba'udah. What is a ba'udah? A mosquito. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not even give the kafir a drink of water. That is the value. And in another hadith, الدُّنْيَا مَلْعُونَةٌ وَمَلْعُونَةٌ مَا فِيهَا إِلَّا ذِكْرَ اللَّهِ وَالْعَالِمَ وَالْمُتَعَلِّمَ وَمَا وَالَاهُمَا. The dunya is cursed, and everything in the dunya is cursed except ذكر الله, which is what Al-Quran Al-Kareem and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. وَالْعَالِمَ, the alim, which alim? The one who teaches كتاب الله وَسُنَّةُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. And that which supports these two things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. That is the enjoyment of the worldly things. وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حُسْنُ الْمَآبِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has what? حُسْنُ الْمَآبِ. The beautiful place of return. What is the beautiful place of return? دار الجنة دار السلام, where a person has the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and a person drinks from Hawdul Kawthar, from the basin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in this day and age, where people are overindulgent in material goods, we as Muslims need to return back to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to do. What is that? Firstly, to increase our iman. How do we increase our iman? I will give you two methods that you adopt from today, inshaAllah ta'ala. One is remembering the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That increases your love for Allah and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How? For instance, those favors we take for granted. This water that we drink, that if we didn't even have water today, that when we came to this gathering, if we did not have water for even 3 days, how would we feel today? One favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there are so many other favors. Like in the narration, narrated in the Mustadrak of Al-Imam Abu Abdullah Al-Hakim rahimahullah ta'ala, who died in the year 405 after Hijri, famous hadith that on the Day of Judgment a man will be brought forth from the previous nations who had worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for 500 years. When his deeds will be weighed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command the angels, take my servant to paradise with my rahmah, with my mercy. The servant will say, by my deeds, O Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will summon the angels to bring the servant back and to weigh the deeds again. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command the angels to place one favor, which is the favor of eyesight, into the scale. The favor of eyesight will outweigh 500 years of ibadah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, take him to hell. The servant will shout, oh Allah, take me to paradise with your mercy. One favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have the favor of eyesight, then the favor of the tongue. Imagine tomorrow, na'udhu billah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-afwa wal-afiyah wa-salama, that we wake up in the morning, we cannot speak, or our minds close down. These are the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if you count them, you cannot count them. Why? From the time you were born, your first heartbeat was a favor. From there until today, each heartbeat is a favor. Each breath we take is a favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So count the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even those things which people deem as a difficulty. Sometimes a person may be born with a disability and they think this disability is a bad thing. But if you notice, those who have a disability, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless them with countless other favors. Like the mercy of the makhluq. The makhluq will have a soft heart towards them, that they will favor them in many ways. This is just one favor. And likewise, in the Quran, إِنَّمَا الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. It's repeated again. Yes? Why? Al-usri, one difficulty. There is yusra, multiple ease. With one specific difficulty, there is multiple ease. Not one ease, multiple ease. So the first way of increasing our iman is remembering the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the greatest favor is Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is the meaning of Mawlid. That we remember the greatest favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second way of increasing iman is through dhikrullah, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we abandon sins, we abandon the sins because the effect of sins comes back to us. that we should maintain firstly, for instance, wudu. Always stay in a state of wudu. Why? Because when waqtu salat enters, the believer then he can pray his five daily prayers. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. Indeed, the prayer upon the believers is كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا, a fixed time. That we do not abandon our salah. مَنْ صَلَّى صَلَاةَ الصُّبْحَ مَنْ صَلَّى صَلَاةَ الصُّبْحِ مَنْ صَلَّى صَلَاةَ الصُّبْحِ كَانَ فِي ذِمَّةِ اللَّهِ. Whoever prays the morning prayer, he will be in the safety of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salatul Fajr. Inna Qur'an al-Fajri kana mashhuda. Indeed, the recitation of the Fajr, Salatul Fajr, is what mashhud, witnessed by the angels. So the first thing of dhikrullah, that we do not abandon our salah. Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. Yes, that indeed the salah, the prayer, it stops what? Prohibits al-fahsha. It prohibits those things which are despicable. Wal-munkar, rejected acts. Why, when a person prays his five daily prayers? Al-insanu murakkabun min ash-shahwati wal-ruh. The insan is made and composed of what? Desires and ruh. The ruh wants to go ascend. Back to Alamul Arwah, to the world of the souls. But the body wants to go down to the desires. So five times a day you need to remind yourself that where we belong is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Alamul Arwah. This is the purpose of the five daily prayers. People say now, with atheist objections, they say, does Allah need our worship? The answer is no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded you to pray in order that your animalistic, bestial nature does not envelop and overwhelm your spiritual goals. That your bestial and carnal nature is overwhelmed with the five daily prayers. And this is the best form of dhikrullah. Then you have recitation of Al-Quran al-Kareem, which is referred to as a dhikr in Al-Qur'an al-Kareem. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Indeed, we revealed this dhikr, which is what? Al-Qur'an al-Kareem. Wa inna lahu lahafidhun. And indeed, we will preserve this Qur'an. Indeed, we will preserve this Qur'an. So, increasing dhikrullah is through recitation of Al-Qur'an al-Kareem. Like I always mention to everyone, the hadith, مَنْ قَرَأَ سُورَةَ الْوَاقِعَةِ كُلَّ لَيْلَةٍ لَنْ تُصِبْهُ فَاقَةٌ. Whoever recites Surah Al-Waqi'ah, every night he will never be afflicted with poverty. Quran. Or in the hadith, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَنْفِرُ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ الَّذِي تُقْرَأُ فِيهِ سُورَةُ الْبَقَرَةِ. Today, people complain about jinn. They complain about sihr. And then they go to the mashaykh. And I'm sure you mashaykh have this problem. They come every day. They complain about sihr. They complain about what? Jinn. But what they do not realize is that if they recited the Quran, no jinn could ever attack them. Some of them, they say, oh, we do this, but it doesn't have an effect. Why? Two reasons. Number one, qillatul yaqeen, lack of certainty. And number two, qillatul amal salih, lack of good action. If the woman is not wearing hijab, and she's walking around with no hijab, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obligated hijab, and he commanded upon us ghaddul basar. If the woman's not wearing the hijab, the man must what? Lower his gaze, not stare. The woman should also lower her gaze. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed the intellect in the brain. He placed the ruh in the heart. And he placed al-haya, modesty, in the eyes. Yes? Then, if we have television playing in the houses, music playing in the houses, then it becomes a majma'u shaytan, a place of the gathering of shaytan. Yes? And then it causes shiqaq bayn al-zawj wal-mar, arguments between a man and a woman. The house environment becomes toxic and dark because shaytan has gathered there. The man may permit men to see his wife, which is the youth. That a man who permits men to see his wife without a hijab is referred to as the youth in the hadith. And then the woman is not wearing hijab. They have music playing in the house. They have movies playing in the house. There's no dhikrullah in the house. Then there are arguments and darkness in the heart. Why? The Quran states, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. Behold, with the dhikrillah, with the remembrance of Allah, the hearts find what? تُمْأَنِينَ. What's تُمْأَنِينَ? Satisfaction. That the hearts find tranquility. So the hadith states, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَنْفِرُ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ الَّذِي تُقْرَأُ فِيهِ سُورَةُ الْبَقَرَةِ. Indeed, the shaytan runs away from a house in which Surah Al-Baqarah is recited. So increasing dhikrullah, Ayatul Kursi, reciting Ayatul Kursi, teaching your children Ayatul Kursi. What are we teaching our children from the age of 4 onwards? They are learning nursery rhymes. They go to the schools where they are brainwashed. They take them out now even to restaurants and to tea places at night time. But are you training your young children in Ayatul Kursi, Suratul Fatiha, Suratul Ikhlas? Because the hadith states in the Musnad of Imam al-Bazzar, the hadith states, whoever recites Suratul Fatiha and Suratul Ikhlas before going to bed, nothing will afflict him until the morning is safe. Just reciting Surah Al-Fatiha and Surah Al-Ikhlas. Are you teaching this to your young children? Teaching them, instilling in them a tawakkul and yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So increasing our love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, increasing our dhikrullah, and abandoning those deeds which displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like what? Like not giving zakat, as I mentioned. Like abandoning the salah, abandoning the 5 daily prayers. Salah is the first fard. Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu, when he would dispatch armies to Iraq to conquer lands, he would say to them, never abandon the prayer. Because the foundation of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the prayer. But when we analyze our society today, the adhan will go, not a single person in some cases will stand up for the salah. Unless of course some of the ulama are present, they may stand up and encourage the others, but generally they do not stand up. They will sit and smoke tobacco. They will sit and discuss al-fudul, ghiba, backbiting. What is ghiba? Ghiba is a man may walk past, he has a limp, and I say, did you see his limp? That's ghiba, backbiting. They say the smell, the repugnance of backbiting in the time of a Salafus Salihun was such that the smell would be, if someone backbited, they could smell it. But in later generations, it became so common, everyone was backbiting, that now people, the way a man, al-buhtan, al-sukhriya, what are these things? Al-Buhtan is making a false claim regarding someone. Namima is tale-bearing, going from one group to another with tales. What is Sukhriya? Sukhriya is making a mockery. Did you see how he looked? Did you see this? Some of the Salaf, as-Salafus Salihun, they said, even if I saw a man drinking the milk of a goat with his mouth directly from the teeth of the goat, I would not laugh at him and make a mockery of him. Why? Because the hand of time will turn. The hand of time will turn. And in years to come, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may have me doing the same thing. So people sit in majalis, smoking tadkhin, and then backbiting, نميمة بهتان, as if they have nothing else to talk about. It shows قلة العقل, lack of intellect, when a person's conversations are so shallow that they need to back by other Muslims. And then the salah time comes in, they abandon salah. The people are encouraged only to accumulate wealth. The youth are told, your goal in life is only to accumulate wealth. What will be the result of that? The drug dealing that we witness in our communities. Because then they believe they need to make quick money. Or the types of robberies that happen, like the Dial Jewelers in Birmingham, somewhere they, you must have seen the videos, they robbed a jewelry shop. Why do they think they need to make quick money? Because they are told that the goal of their life is just to accumulate wealth, just to make wealth, nothing else. What is the goal of our lives? The goal of our lives is التقرب إلى الله, closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Halawatul iman, that we feel the sweetness of our faith when we pray five times a day. At-ta'abbud, ubudiyah, servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we have shuhud of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our ibadah, in our acts of worship. Lastly, before finishing, I would like to point out what is a part of this ailment is that when people live in a majority non-Muslim society, they forget our culture is not Indian, our culture is not Pakistani, our culture is not Bengali, our culture is not Arab, our culture is not British, our culture, whatever we may, wherever we may be, what is above the culture is the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes? The wahda, wahdatul Islam. Wahdatul Islam. For instance, when the inception of Pakistan was done, the mistake that they did, they wrote down as the national language as Urdu. The language should have been Arabic. The Idari language, institutional language, should have been Arabic. Why? Then later in 1971, the Bengali Muslims would, and the Urdu-speaking Muslims could never have a conflict, because what unites them is Al-Quran Al-Kareem. Yes, but when they make their identity, racial identity, even though Pakistan is a nation state, it's not an ethnic group. Today, Indian Muslims have the Indian flag when in reality they should have the Mughal flag. Yes, our identity is Islam. And wherever we may be, we could, this is the awliya Allah Salihin, their identity was Islam. If we go to South America to spread Islam, our identity is Islam. If we go to Africa to spread Islam, our identity is Islam. So when they live in a cultural area, they become influenced by certain cultural norms. Living here in the UK, some people do not instruct their children that the celebration of Christmas is haram, prohibited in the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, Al-Imam Jalaluddin Abdul Rahman Al-Suyuti rahimahullah ta'ala, who wrote his book Al-Husn Al-Maqsid Fi Amal Al-Mawlid, he wrote a fatwa permitting Mawlid, but he also wrote a fatwa prohibiting Christmas in his book Al-Amru Bil-Ittiba' Wal-Nahyu Anil-Ibtida', the command to follow the Sunnah and the prohibition of innovation. Christmas is a bid'ah in religion. You cannot celebrate as Muslims Christmas. Likewise, you cannot celebrate Halloween. Halloween is a pagan ritual. Instruct your children that on this night the pagans gather, and what do? They carry out their paganistic rituals, blood sacrifice, worship of the moon, worship of celestial bodies, shirk billah, polytheism with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, it's the season of Diwali. There is no place for Diwali and Holi in Islam. We do not celebrate any of these things. Islam, al-Islamu ya'lu wa la yu'la alayh. Islam is always dominant and is never dominated upon. Like some people, they bring in Christians to sing hymns in the masjid. Waliyadu billah. Yes, and they use the event When the Christians of Najran came to the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is the response? The response is those Christians did this out of their own accord, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam initially left them, but later on they were challenged. Why do they not mention the challenge? Which challenge? The challenge to al-mubahala. And when the challenge to mubahala came, Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went out with Sayyiduna Ali and Sayyidatuna Fatima alayhi salam, and Sayyiduna al-Imam al-Hasan wal-Husayn radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. They went out, and when the Christians saw their faces, they said, these are not people that we can do al-mubahala with. So where is your mubahala with the Christians when they come to your masjid? So do not let them misquote these events. Or for instance, to validate Christmas, some people say, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered al-Madinah al-Munawwarah, the Jews were fasting. And when they were questioned, why do you fast? They said, this was the day Allah saved us from Fir'aun. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, نَحْنُ أَوْلَى بِمُوسَى. We are more deserving of Musa alayhi salam. But there are two things. Number one, the day was confirmed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Christmas Day is a pagan festival. It celebrates the winter solstice. It's not the date of birth. Secondly, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam changed the way of worship by fasting on 9th of Muharram and 10th of Muharram. Thirdly, the Christians deem Isa alayhi salam as the son of Allah. There is a big difference between the two. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us firm on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That no one leaves this hall except we all do tawbah. Anyone who hasn't been praying 5 times a day, make intention that from this day on you will be praying your 5 daily prayers. Any of the sisters who do not wear hijab, that they make the intention from now on, when they will leave, they will wear the hijab that covers their modesty. The value of a woman is higher when she is modest. Yes, any of the men who have been drinking alcohol, they do tawbah, that before they leave, they will do tawbah from drinking alcohol. Anyone who has been smoking cannabis, that they do tawbah, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, kullu muskirin haram. Every intoxicant is haram, that they will never touch cannabis again. Anyone who has been doing zina, adultery and fornication, do tawbah for this sin. Why? It cuts down your risk. It cuts down your lifespan. It removes the noor from your face. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُ الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. Do not even approach zina, adultery and fornication, sexual sins. Why? It is immodesty, فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا, bad way of relieving your desires. So before leaving today, if anyone has been gambling, any of these sins, Ya Sattar, cover the sins. Ya Allah, Ya Ghaffar, ighfir dhanubana. Allahumma ighfir lana dhanubana. Wa adhib ghayza qulubina. Wa ajirna min mudillati fitani ma ahyaytana. Ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Wa sallallahu sallam wa baraka ala sayyidina Muhammad. Jazallahu anna sayyidina Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ma huwa ahluh. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala.